The government shutdown has now gone into day 25, day 26, depending on when you hear this show. This is the longest government shutdown in American history, with an estimated 800,000 federal employees getting paychecks with the number zero on it. It's almost like a residual from Comedy Central. 3 weeks without pay has forced many federal employees to go on food stamps, renegotiate their mortgages, take side gigs, and hold garage sales. How is it possible that federal employees, who in many ways are the backbone of America's middle class, how is it possible that so many federal employees are one paycheck away from falling through the cracks? For more on this, we are joined by Alissa Quart, author of Squeezed, Why Our Families Can't Afford America. It's published by HarperCollins. Thank you for taking time to be with us.
Oh, it's great to be here, David.
I should also mention that you're executive editor of the Economic Hardship Reporting Project, economichardship.org. Everybody should go there. The inability of people to work their way out of poverty in America is the issue of our time.
Well, it's definitely the issue for people in journalism as well, but it's the issue for people in all kinds of walks of life, as we're discovering: federal employees, accountants, lawyers, librarians, teachers, the backbone of our country, really. And one of the things I noticed when I was reporting my book, Squeezed, was the closer people's work got to caring about others, the worse paid they were. So, you know, if you're dealing with stocks all day and you're not really dealing with human beings as much, you're going to be making a lot more than if you're working with kids.
Mm-hmm. Which is why I guess it's more important. Working with mm-hmm. kids should be more important than trading paper on Wall Street. And yet they put on their $3,000 suits and go off to those high-rise office buildings, and they're respectable. They don't have shame. And yet you write in the New York Times, and that's why I reached out to you, that there's almost this self-policing that's going on with the middle class. The shame of not having enough money keeps people in line. They're not storming the Bastille because they're ashamed of not having money.
I mean, one woman told me she felt like she was running in place as fast as she could to stay the same, to quote Alice in Wonderland's Red Queen, and she was a graphic designer in Laguna Beach. You know, I talked to families whose the mom was paying for so-called extras because she couldn't pay her rent for her three kids by making them do medical tests and other kinds of, you know, one kid was getting MRIs to earn a little extra for the family. And this woman is a registered nurse. So this is the world that I cover in my book, and that I inspired me to write this opinion piece, where I try to talk about this shame and how, for me, the most important thing for us to do as citizens is to be open about what we're struggling with economically and psychologically and professionally, and then for politicians to witness that and to respond to it and to talk openly about debt and people working multiple jobs. I think Elizabeth Warren is starting to do that a lot.
Yeah, I was just going to say Elizabeth Warren for president. I hate to use the cliche, we're only as sick as our secrets, but it's applicable in this case because I think we're sick. I think America is very sick. The secret, and you write about this in the New York Times, and that's why I reached out to you, is we're sick and we're ashamed of this sickness. We're ashamed of our lack of financial resources. Or we're ashamed that we have so much money, we don't want people to know about it.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole world now of people who are called everything from money coaches to inequality therapists. There's actually something, inequality therapists. And I write about some of these people in my book, and also about people who now counsel former lawyers. There's a group called Leave Law Behind. The shame and the stigma around money and the necessity for the middle class historically to be private about their monetary affairs and their struggles, right? That's one of the ways we see ourselves as middle class, is that we don't have to get help from anyone, right? We're alone in our siloed house with our 2.2 kids or whatever. And this is part of what making it has meant. But what I'm arguing in this op-ed was, no, we have to come out, in a sense, talk about what is troubling us, get rid of our obsession with privacy on this front, because otherwise we're just going to harm our own ability to organize. We'll identify with the rich rather than identify with other people who are struggling, so we can't ever make an effective difference.
You write that the middle class and the poor have more in common with one another than they do with the ultra elite. How bad is it for the middle class right now?
It's not just earning power. Obviously, up until recently, you know, there's a low unemployment rate, but there was very little wage growth, right? It's something like 0.3, and now that's not even happening. And it was also a question of expenses. You have college educations that are double or triple what they were 20 years ago. And as we all know, this is another way that middle-class people see themselves as becoming part of the bourgeois, right? By bourgeoisie, by getting a master's or just a bachelor's degree. But if it's costing this much, people wind up in debt. So some of this is about job security and earning, but a lot of this is about expenses and is about housing as well. One of the things I advocate for is that politicians locally and federally should be embracing fixes that address this. Like, there's a scholarship program in New York State that Cuomo, of all people, put in place, where there's almost 1 million middle-class families, people making up to $125,000 per year, and they qualify to attend tuition-free at colleges in New York State and New York City in the public university system. And that wasn't a perfect program. I've heard complaints from students. You have to keep a high attendance and grades and all that. It's like it's very difficult for some people who have less organized lives. But to me, that's what politicians should be advocating. These are the kind of programs we need. We need universal pre-K for families like mine, which, you know, we wound up spending a huge chunk of our salary early on in daycare just so we could continue to work. And this is the bread and butter issues that I think the Democrats really need to be thinking imaginatively about.
I look at the teachers' strike in L.A., and the teachers are asking for more money, but they're being made to feel guilty by going on strike because so many children in L.A. are dependent on the schools for their breakfasts and their lunches.
Well, yeah, this is actually in my book. I spent some time talking to Uber drivers who are teachers. This is an actual program that Uber had that was actually predominantly in California, where all these school teachers, some of whom were unionized, were driving Uber and Lyft on the side after school, at night, you know, on weekends, of course, in the summer. And it just brought home to me what we do or don't do for our teachers. I mean, I'm so happy that there's been this wave of teachers' strikes and organizing in red states. And my colleague, Barbara Ehrenreich at the Economic Hardship Reporting Project, was just suggesting actually that, you know, this is what federal workers should do. They should follow in the wake of these, I think it was six states where there were teacher strikes.
Are federal workers allowed to go on strike?
Interesting question.
I know that Reagan fired the air traffic control.
PATCO, right, yeah. PATCO. That was right now what they're doing is not a strike. It's what they call blue flu, which means they're staying home with their quote-unquote sick, because they're obviously not being paid.
Right.
You know, a strike by TSA agents and federal workers would be illegal, but, I don't know, people are saying, like a professor of law just said, this time is different because, you know, it's a strike over involuntary work, and it would raise novel issues. Because, I mean, since the 19th century, we're used to people, or 18th century in America, people working for very low wages, but this is people working for no wages. So maybe this would raise a different set of legal precedents. So this isn't even my issue, but this is kind of thoughts I've had on around the federal worker strike, potentially.
This is a political issue, and you write, what the electorate doesn't need to hear are Horatio Alger stories of how candidates work their way up from humble origins with the implied moral that anyone can make it in America with enough hard work. I find that so spot on. By the way, Horatio Alger was a pedophile.
Oh, I know. I started looking into Horatio Alger and went down that rabbit hole, and wow.
Yeah.
And
in a way, the Horatio Alger myth turns out to be pretty abusive towards our kids. It leads to hunger and lack of education. It's only fitting that the people who worship Horatio Alger would be worshiping a child abuser, because children are being abused because of this Horatio Alger myth. There's no such thing as rags to riches.
Right. And I guess part of what I want to get across is that there's all these master narratives, everything from Horatio Alger's to Lean In, that are telling us that we can just, if we just push through, if we just bootstrap, if we just ask for that raise, even though our jobs are imperiled, we'll be okay. And why aren't we doing these things? And the point I'm making over and over again is that, you know, this is the language of the hateful Trump, President Trump, it's rigged. And if you do ask for these things and you're not in a position with leverage, or if you do expect yourself to be able to bootstrap, you're going to wind up with a whole bunch of self-hatred and shame. And I think for politicians, they need to start addressing that instead of talking about their granddaddy, the miner. Mm-hmm. First of all, you know, our representatives are now, I think, a majority millionaire. This isn't helpful for them to be talking about their granddaddy, the miner, when we know that it's been many generations since some of these people have ever seen a Trader Joe's, let alone a welfare roll. Generally, let's retire this. Let's have politicians ask people about their debt, talk about people that they do know that have experienced struggles. It doesn't have to be them or their own story, but just open this up, and so it's not this shameful, silent thing for so many people.
There's a tendency in America to look at somebody who's fallen through the cracks, and if you look hard enough, you can find something they did that brought it on themselves. And it's not bad luck. This is how we've been programmed to think. It's not bad luck. There was something that they did that caused their financial hardship. If you look hard enough, you will find something.
It's kind of the way we punish people when they're ill, too, right? We create stories about why they got ill. Almost like it's this way to protect ourselves from how any affliction can harm any of us at any time, you know? And I think that's one way to think about the punitive language around class in America and economic struggle. And also, I mean, somebody said to me at one of the events I've done, you know, well, you could just cherry pick any of these stories and you'd find all these people who are struggling. You know, numbers don't lie. And, you know, that when people say things like that, I start to think like, well, actually, you can cherry pick the numbers too and find low unemployment numbers. But then if you scratch the surface, you'd find, and you wanted to tell another story, like the kind of story I'm interested in telling, you could find lots of people working multiple jobs or working miserable jobs.
Well, I talk about this all the time on my show. There's a story about Iowa where all the candidates have to go to be vetted. It has the second lowest unemployment rate in America, and yet 40% of people who live in Iowa can't make ends meet. What more do our candidates need to be told? If you want to win the presidency, people came out to see Elizabeth Warren last week in Iowa. She gets it. 40%,
she does get it.
40% of the people in Iowa are working. They're all employed, but they can't pay the essentials.
So, yeah, I was really pleased by some of the things she said in her Iowa speech. She actually did a lot of the things that I'm arguing candidates should do. For instance, she talked about debt. She talked about her own experience with it. She talked about, you know, many of the people's lives that she was encountering. And she also talked even further about the corruption, political corruption that and tax corruption, if you want to call it that, that underlies the struggle some of these people are having. And I didn't get into that as much in this op-ed. I didn't have the space, but, you know, these are the causations of it, right? It's not coming from inside you, from some moral failing. It's because your tax rate is not really a very democratic one if you're middle class and below.
I think back to the 60s and Lyndon Johnson bringing us Medicare and Medicaid and lifting people out of poverty. And it did work. I mean, the Great Society under Lyndon Johnson lifted people out of poverty. You know, I can remember pictures of Bobby Kennedy as a senator going to Appalachia and seeing the kids with the bloated stomachs. And America was appalled, and something had to be done. What happened? What happened to this country that we now blame the kid with the bloated stomach?
Yeah.
Were we reprogrammed somehow along the way?
Well, there is a kind of numbing politically that may have happened, and, you know, over decades of people seeing images of suffering people. Like, this was the birth of a visual mass media, right? So maybe this was one of the earlier moments where people from the 30s on, where people were seeing images of American poverty, and over decades people became inured to it. There's other people that have theorized that it's racism, that when it was this sort of traditional white, you know, Appalachian poverty, people sympathized, white middle-class people did, and upper-class people, and identified, and that there's racism at work when people don't identify across those lines. And there's probably something to that as well. But I also think a lot of it is our rhetoric, and a lot of it is I actually write about this in my book, 1% Television, from The Apprentice onwards, mm-hmm. which was just always about the richest people.
Mm-hmm.
These very positive stories about them. And I eat the stuff up too. I mean, I watch Billions, just like the next girl, you know, and it's a celebrity culture too, where it's uncritical of Gwyneth Paltrow and all these other people who are just living this ridiculous affluent life and have no interest in anyone else. And I think that's where the public's eyes and imagination have gone.
It's literally escapist television. You're escaping from your problems, which is okay, but there's so much escapism now that you're identifying with your oppressor.
Yeah, you're identifying with your oppressor, yes.
Paul Anthony Gosar is a congressman from Arizona, and there was a story about him in the Washington Post a couple of days ago. His family, his siblings, his five siblings came out against him when he was running for re-election. They said he's a horrible human being. He's a climate change denier. He's for getting rid of Obamacare. He won't accept the Pope anymore because the Pope speaks for the poor. So he didn't want the president to greet the Pope on a visit to the United States. They did a portrait of Congressman Gosar's siblings. He's got a sister who lives in Wyoming who is a doctor, who has cancer and can't pay her bills. I think it's like stage 4 cancer. She's working at a medical clinic. She's a doctor, and she's bankrupt. Congressman Paul Gosar won't acknowledge her problems. We turn our back on our own sister, a doctor, who certainly lifted herself up. If you're a doctor and you can't make ends meet, and you've got cancer, your brother is a congressman, he's a Republican. What's his excuse other than being a sociopath?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, there's also a lot of alienated families in this country as well. Not that that explains anything. But, you know, when I listen to some of the discourse of the Republicans right now, yeah, I wouldn't say sociopathic, but twisted and delighted in denying their own vulnerability and that of other people. So there's a real investment in that, in not seeing anyone as having any needs, including themselves.
You're right about the 1% media. They don't focus on the despair or the human carnage, to quote Donald Trump. The mass media doesn't want to show it because in many ways they've caused it. Tell me about your relationship with Barbara Ehrenreich, who I think is one of the first people to focus on the middle class not being able to make ends meet. So tell me a little bit about Barbara Ehrenreich, and let's promote some of her books if we could.
Yeah, well, I'd like to promote the organization that she founded and I kind of basically co-founded a year later. It's called the Economic Hardship Reporting Project.
It's great. And it's great.
The site is economichardship.org. So everyone should go on, read, write for us, donate if you're so inclined. But what we do is we publish work about American income inequality, from everything from poverty to wealth. I did a story for us on people who come out as rich, which is a whole interesting movement. You know, from the ways in which environmental disasters actually do happen in poor areas, there's a correlation, to stories by people who are themselves living low income. Somebody in Alaska who doesn't define himself as homeless, he defines himself as houseless. And mm-hmm. he wrote an essay and we then co-published. So that piece, for instance, by the man who sees himself as houseless, that came out in The Guardian. We also published with, you know, New York Review of Books, Time Magazine. We funded the Time Magazine story on the teachers with the photos of the teachers on the cover. Mm-hmm. So basically, when you're looking at mainstream media and there's an inequality story that you're like, how did that get on in this paper? We're often behind it.
Right, and it's like kind of like a ProPublica that specializes in income inequality.
Yeah, with a slightly more expressive and probably politically edgy bent. So expressive in the sense it's, you know, a quarter of our grant recipients are lower income, and so sometimes they're doing photos or photo projects or pieces about their life, and it's first person and it's very alive. You know, it's not like, you know, just the news, ma'am. And the project, part of why we want these kind of pieces, somebody wrote about how when she was homeless, she basically didn't sleep for 2 years. And why? Because, you know, if you sleep, someone can hurt you in right. your sleep. If you're cold, et cetera. I see empathy as my metric, and to get that first-person kind of detailed, granular voice out there, to me is that's how we're going to make change. How are we going to cut through these 1% TV narratives, except with something that's as compelling? Mm-hmm. And so that's where the kind of heart and soul first-person stuff comes in.
Talk to me a little bit about Barbara Ehrenreich. I met her once at a fundraiser for Public Citizen. She's one of my heroes because she exposed the open wound during the Reagan administration. She wrote Nickeled and Dimed. She's white, privileged. She's part of the literati, the well-educated writers of New York and Washington, D.C. She writes for The Nation. And I would assume a lot of New York writers who call themselves liberals didn't really know how tough it was for most Americans. And she went out and took a job, I think, in a hotel, a motel, Holiday Inn.
Like a motel or like a low level.
I was rapping there first. Hang on, I was hotel, motel, Holiday Inn.
Hotel, motel, no-tel. Yeah, and so she, and then she worked in a store. She worked in a restaurant, and she did it. I think she went under her maiden name, so it was undercover, but it was, you know, she didn't have to falsify her identity or anything like that. You know, she reported on how people, your boss goes through your stuff, and this still happens when you're working, you know, minimum wage jobs or at a restaurant. Like at the end of the day, the boss will feel like he can just go through your stuff, supposedly in case you've stole something, mm-hmm. but it's a real violation. You know, imagine at that point, she was probably at that point a middle-aged woman, and they're opening up her bag, you know, at 6 o'clock after the blinds have been closed.
It makes for a pliant electorate. When you're desperate for money, you'll work, you're exhausted, so you'll believe anything you're told.
Yeah. No, I think that's a lot of what we're seeing. We're seeing people who are working long and irregular hours. And in my book, I write about this. I write about a related phenomenon, which I call extreme daycare, which is the 9% of American daycare now happens on odd hours, like early mm-hmm. in the morning, late at night, overnight, weekends. And in my book, I embed myself for a couple of days in this 24-hour daycare facility.
Wow.
And that was a real eye-opener because that showed me how people are working. There are moms who are dropping off kids at 7:30, picking them up again at 12, and then taking them for lunch, then coming back at 10 at night, you know. So these kids weren't seeing very much of their parents. And how on earth is that parent going to then be able to be alert enough and follow politics enough to vote, organize, you know, protect themselves?
We're talking with Alissa Quart. She's author of Squeezed, Why Our Families Can't Afford America. It's published by HarperCollins. I have a daughter who says, you cannot talk about this without discussing abortion. Your book is entitled Why Our Families Can't Afford America. So families, what is the role abortion plays in all this?
Well, it's interesting you should ask me this because I've produced and wrote a number of films around choice, and in particular, I executive produced a film with the EHRP that won the Emmy for Best Documentary about a social issue, and it's called Jackson, and it's about the last abortion clinic in Mississippi.
It's interesting. I had Liz Winstead on the show and Greg Proops. They did a great podcast on the same subject.
we started working on this. This is actually how I met Barbara. Mm-hmm. The director of that film, me and her started working on this in 2012. And we got our first grant from EHRP before I even worked for the organization. And we went and made this movie. She directed it. I wrote and produced it, whatever. It was called The Last Clinic. And then that was expanded to be this film called Jackson. That was a feature. And I saw a lot of things when I was reporting that and thinking about that. I mean, I saw a lot of lower-income people who had traveled across the state. I saw the ways that not having one clinic and having these waiting periods, you'd have to wait, and obstructing even that clinic's ability to perform its tasks was going to be an economic hardship for people, for families, because
yeah.
These people would have to take off work, these young women, leave another kid usually, because many of the people having abortions have kids, and that's something that people like to forget, but in some ways, somebody said something to me once at this clinic, I'm doing this for the other child.
Wow.
And that's a typical sentiment. And
So abortion is an economic issue.
I think it's completely an economic issue. And I think that, you know, for its opponents, they think it's a moral issue. And it's not a position that I don't understand. I mean, it's in a way I understand how you could feel that way if you're religious, but I think that they're often overlooking the hardship. I mean, in Jackson, this woman had many kids. She's very young. She's utterly, utterly indigent, didn't have an education. And she was being convinced over the course of the film to not have a termination. So she wound up having the kid. And then she got pregnant again with twins. And there was this one woman who's pro-life, white, older, trying to convince her to not terminate, but all she did was bring over diapers at some point, you know. There was no support, there was no services. These kids were like playing in the dirt in the inside and the house that they lived in, and I just felt like, wow, this is obviously about economic justice as much as it's about anything.
If you look at, you know, Steve Scalise and these Republicans who are pro-life, you know, deep down inside, they've tapped into, if they're not having sex with me, hell with them.
That's fascinating. I mean, I know you're joking, but it's also, I mean, you're kind of giving like an incel narrative for the war on choice.
It's a form of control. It's to create women who are subordinate. It forces women to stay home and be broke and malleable when they do go off for a job.
One of the things that I've written about around this is also what I call the Red State Derby, which is all these states who have for years now been in competition to see who can be the first state to get rid of an abortion clinic entirely.
Yeah.
And obviously, under Roe versus Wade, you can't do that, but they're going to use local laws, bans on abortions after 12 weeks with limited exceptions, all this kind of thing, these trap laws that mean that, and I witnessed this when I was, you know, reporting on this, like the doctors and the nurses at this clinic were trying to figure out how they were going to be able to treat people because there was some new law that, you know, the bathroom had to be this many feet from the operating room and that hallways had to be narrowed.
Yeah.
And again, you know, all the women there were poor and the people outside were all white. I don't know how privileged they were, but they were much older. And I also saw it in some ways as a kind of ageist thing, too. It's like they were resentful of...
You're talking about the people who...
The protesters. The protesters were all very old.
Yeah.
And the women, of course, were, you know, very young, fertile women, and they were 22, you know. There's a woman who worked in Yazoo City in an auto shop, and she had two children, and one baby had been born at 2 pounds, the other at 4 pounds. And she said I had bad prenatal care. And then that's why she was in this clinic, because she wanted to prevent another child being born underweight because she knew she was not going to be able to afford decent care.
Yeah.
So this is absolutely economic. I mean, it's somewhat different than the squeezed paradigm and that we've been talking about, the middle class paradigm, because, again, this is something that affects the working poor and the very, very poor more than it affects middle class people. This is one of the few advantages middle class people have, that they have the cultural capital to find out where the clinic is, to know how to navigate existing grants, you know, because you can get grants for from the NAF, which is the National Abortion Foundation, National Abortion Federation.
Right.
You know, when you're middle class, you know these kind of things. And that's something that is one of the few privileges left for the middle class, is that there's this thing called accumulated advantage, where people who have a certain amount of education and standing sort of do know how to manipulate systems. And I do write about that in Squeezed. Like, they know how to manipulate, some of the Squeezed families know how to manipulate the educational system so they can get their kids into decent public schools.
Right.
Whereas the working class character in my book doesn't have that. So that there are gaps, there are points where there isn't solidarity.
Right. I brought up Liz Winstead from Lady Parts Justice League. She created The Daily Show. Have you met her? I'd like to
introduce. I'd love to meet her.
Yeah, she'd be a great.
I want to be on The Daily Show. Put me on The Daily Show.
Well, she's no. She created it, but she left a long time ago.
She probably lives in Montclair, where all those people live.
Actually, no. I think she's in Brooklyn, and she's devoted most of her career to abortion rights. She started something called Lady Parts Justice League, and they travel around the country and they do comedy shows inside abortion clinics, and then they stay, paint and garden, assist the people who work in the abortion clinics, and they walk the women, the girls, through the phalanx of protesters and hold their hands and talk to them. It's an interesting organization, and it's a lot of comedians who help Liz Winstead. She did an interesting project down in Jackson with Greg Proops. I'll send you the tape. And they interviewed the protesters who were yelling at the girls as they're walking towards the abortion clinic. One of the things you realize, because it's very patient, Greg Proops and Liz, when they interviewed these protesters, they were very patient with them and listened. And you realize they're victims, too, and they're being manipulated. They got bigger problems than whether or not somebody's going to remove an itch from their belly.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you Liz's number. You two should do something together. I want to talk about the laws of attraction before you go.
Okay.
It's used by Oprah. It's used by the 1% to convince the 99% that all they have to do is think and envision, good things will come their way. But there are laws of attraction that are applicable in this conversation. A few months ago, I read Pound Foolish. It was written by Helene Olin. And then I read a couple of her pieces in Slate, The Washington Post. And I said to myself, wow, Helene Olin is a brilliant writer. She's talking about exactly what I care about. And I went out and found Helene Olin, and I begged her to do my show. And she does our show a lot when time allows. Then I read your piece in the New York Times, and I begged to get you on, and I got you on. And then as I'm prepping for this interview, I see that you are the chief officer of the Economic Hardship Reporting Project. And I said, that sounds familiar. I go there all the time. Who else do I? Oh, Helene Olin is
yes.
on the advisory board.
It's a cabal of mouthy broad. No, but seriously, Helene's my kind of lady. It's like, so is Barbara. You know, like these are strong women who have a sense of humor about finance and recognize class struggle while they recognize you need to report things soundly to be able to make that argument. You know, so that I think we share an ethos, all three of us.
There is a book that everybody should go out and buy. It's called Squeezed, Why Our Families Can't Afford America. It's published by HarperCollins. It's written by Alissa Quart. She's the executive editor of the Economic Hardship Reporting Project, economichardship.org. Go there every day and you will see articles written for the New York Times, the San Francisco Chronicle, the Nation, stories about the issue of our time, economic hardship in the wealthiest country in the world. In the history of civilization, this is the wealthiest country ever. And yet, roughly 40% of us are broke. And as Helene Olin always points out, something like 60% of Americans can't get their hands on $1,000 without borrowing it.
Mm-hmm.
As I always say, what kind of country is this? Alissa Quart, thank you so much for joining us. Can you stay on the line for 1 second?
Absolutely.